In this video, we will look at creating a seamless texture using three generative tools in Substance Sampler. The generated texture is just the first step in the material creation process and can help you create quick iterations. It's great for concepting and saving time. Let's take a look. Let's start with text to texture. So here on the left toolbar, you can see that I have this generative beta option. Now, this button may be closer towards the bottom of your UI. You can move these buttons around. I keep mine up here towards the top, and I'm going to click to access the generative tools. And I can undock this panel, and I'm just going to park it right here on the left side of the UI. Okay, so text to texture. So you can see the type is set to texture. Now for the text input, I'm going to enter a prompt. So I'll type in ground with small rocks. Okay, so I have a basic prompt. Now, if you mouse over this information window, you can see that there are some options to manage the prompts. And one of those is using the no flag. So you can use this no before words or phrases that you want to exclude. So to give you an example, I'm going to use this no flag and then type in plants. So hopefully we won't get any plants in my ground with small rocks texture. Now I'll just click generate, and Sampler is going to create four variations of this texture. Now these textures that are being generated are going to be seamless, so that's going to save me some time in that I don't have to do any of the manual tiling work in my layer stack. And here we have some results, and as you can see, this gives me this ground with small rocks, and I don't see any plants, so this is working as I would expect. So now what I can do is just choose one of these images that I want to work with, and I think maybe this one would be pretty good, so I can just left click to select it, and that's going to make a few extra options available for me here at the bottom of the panel. Number one, I can add this to my layers, which is going to be my layer stack. And number two, I can add to my assets. So for example, if I click this add to your assets, you can see the image is copied to the assets. So here, if I jump over to my assets browser, and if you're looking at this, you'll see you have all libraries, starter, and your assets. We'll click your assets, and then here you can see that the image has now been saved. This is the one that maybe I want to use. So now it's just part of my assets, and I can use it within any project. Okay, so let's jump back. We have this guy selected. Let's click Add to Layers, and that's going to open up the material creation template, which gives me the option to use image to material, which is exactly what I want. Now here for my options, I could set this to say something like 4K, and this is going to open up the ability to use this upscale material. So as I said, that generated texture is going to come in as a square 2K by 2K texture that's automatically been tiled for me. Now, if I use this upscale with my document size set to 4K, it's going to use machine learning to upscale that texture so that I have an actual true 4K image. So again, it just helps with quality. Now, we can do this ahead of time as I'm doing here with image to material, or you can actually work with the upscale as a filter inside your layer stack. So in this case, I just want to mention that this capability is here, but I'm just going to turn everything off, just set it down to 2K, just so things run a little bit more smooth during the tutorial. We'll click import, and now the layer stack is being processed. We have the image input, and image to material is now starting to create my full material from that generated texture input. And there we go, we have the material. Now, if I look here in my 2D view and I hit T on the keyboard, T for tiling, you can see that indeed this input image is now seamless and it is tiling for me. And as I said before, this is just a nice time saver. I don't have to jump into the layer stack and try to do any manual tiling. So now I'm using Sampler's filters to go through the process of adding to this material, using things like the clone stamp to remove repeating patterns, also using dirt and water, again, just to kind of make this more of a mud, realistic looking material. So here you can see that I've generated more variations just by clicking Generate More, and now I have 8 different textures. All of the textures that I've been generating are available in the History tab. So if I go over to History, you can see here's a bunch of the different variations that I've been generating based on this initial prompt. I can copy this prompt to the clipboard if I want to use it again. Also, if I select one of the variations, I have the option to add to layers to create a material or add to my assets as I shown previously. Using Manage, I can clear the history or I can open the folder where all of these generated textures exist. Now, if you do copy the prompt and regenerate, you'll probably get different results because there is quite a bit of randomness. I like to think of it like a 3D slot machine. You know, you never know what you're going to get. So if you do want to try to get the exact same result, one thing that you can do is, let's say this image here. I want to basically regenerate this exact image. So I can right click here and then choose to copy the image seed. And this is going to copy that image seed number. Now you need to use the same exact prompt with the image seed. So if I jump back to generate, I can see that that prompt is still here. And then if I just come over and now that I've copied the image seed, I'll just paste it here and you can see it gives me this new flag for seed and the seed number. Now if I click generate, Sampler will regenerate the texture using the same seed value and you'll get the exact same result. So this can be a way if you ever need to regenerate a specific texture again. So now I can jump back to my history and I can use any of these generated images and replace the input image in my layer stack. And this allows me to quickly just update my material. So here I'll just drag in another image, the layer stack will recompute and I'll get a new material. And since the generated textures are seamless, I don't have to worry about manually adjusting any tiling filters in my layer stack. Next, we're going to take a look at using image to texture. So what this allows me to do is input an image here into the text or image input window, and Sampler will generate variations based on that reference input. So I can click this button here to load the image, or I can simply just drag and drop the image here into the window. So I'm gonna do that. Let me just grab an image. I'm gonna just drag and drop. You can see I'm gonna place it right here. And now I have the image. This is my reference image, and I'll click generate. And now Sampler is going to generate four variations from that input image. What's interesting here is, you know, this is just a photograph that I took in my backyard. I brought it in. I'm going to generate four different variations or more if I continue clicking the generate button. But Sampler is going to return to me again another seamless texture based on that reference input image. And here we go. I now have this seamless reference image and I have four different variations of that bark texture. So now all I have to do is find one that I want to work with. Let's say maybe this guy, I'll select it and then just simply add to my layers using the same steps I just shown. We're going to use image to material again. We'll click import and image to material is now going to create a full material based on that source input image. And here we have our bark material. Now for the category, it's set to ground by default, but I'm going to change it here in this case. Let's scroll down. There is a wood outdoor lighting, which is going to work a lot better for this tree bark. So now let image to material reprocess that image. And here we're getting a bit better result here for that bark material. So you might be thinking, hey, you took the image with your camera. Why not just use the image with image to material? Why go through all this generative process here? And that's a great question. There are two benefits. Number one, Sampler will make the image seamless for me, and that can save time. Tiling bark is never fun. Number two, this process is creating more textures from a source input that I control. I can take reference photos, which I'm always doing, and have Sampler create some seamless textures from those references with variation. So here's just another example. I have this texture library that I've been keeping just when I'm out. I'm taking reference photos or just any kind of texture reference. And then I just look through. I had a grass that I thought would be good. So I just dropped this in, generated a couple variations that are already seamless, running through some sampler work here to, you know, create the material. And there we go. I have a grass material. So now we're going to take a look at text to pattern. Now I'll change the type to pattern. And for the input, I'm going to try decorative floral. And let's hit generate and see what we get. Okay, so I have some results here. And these are interesting. So let's see what we can do with this. Because of this pattern, I'm really going to focus on creating a cloth. So let's jump over to my viewer settings. And I'm going to use this little cloth material. And so like I said, we're gonna use some of these patterns here. Now, of course, we could generate more, but for now, let's maybe go with, I don't know, maybe this guy here. So there's several different ways we can use this. Number one, let's come over here to our layers, and I am going to grab a cloth weave. And so this is gonna create for me a cloth weave material. Let's make a few adjustments. So the displacement's pretty high right now. I'm just gonna bring that down. I'll take the displacement quality down. Okay, so already you can see that I'm starting to get here some type of cloth material. Now, there is a custom color weave option for this. So I'm going to enable this. And now all I need to do is just take one of my examples here of my pattern. Let's grab this one here, left click, drag and drop, and just add it to the custom color weave input. And there we're starting to get something, which is interesting. So now what I need to do is just change the warp and weft pattern size. So for example, it's set to 8. I can change the values here, but I could also just change the size multiplier. So if we click this, you have like, you know, times 4, times 8, times, let's try a times 10 and see what this does. And there we go. Now we're starting to get something here. Looks interesting. Again, I'm just going to take that displacement height scale down a lot. Okay, so now we're starting to get something. Let's just keep playing with it. Maybe go times 20. Ah, there we go. That looks pretty cool. And there we go. I have a cloth just like that. And if I want to see, you know, different variations of this, I can, you know, go in and try different patterns. Let's see what this one does. Drag and drop, place, and boom, it changes. And now we have, you know, just a different pattern. Of course, with cloth weave, there's lots of options here. You can even go in and change the actual weave pattern. So for example, it's on plain, but I can change that to anything. For example, twill, and we'll get a different pattern result for our cloth. And like I said, there's lots of options here that we can choose from. Here's what basket looks like. But I think I'm just gonna go back to plain. This looks pretty good for what I wanna do. Let's take a look at using the pattern filter. So to start this off, I'm gonna jump over to my assets and let's just go to the starter assets. And I'm just gonna find something like, there's this denim, let's just use this. I don't know, there's different materials, but I'm just gonna grab denim and I'm just gonna drag and drop and place this here into the layer stack. So in this use case, I have a material, as you can see here, and I want to be able to use this material as my base and then add a pattern on top of it. So what I'll do is come over to add layer, and this time I am going to use the pattern filter. So we'll add the pattern filter here on top. Now for this, I'm going to try just a different pattern, and let's come over again, type set to pattern, and let's do zigzag. Let's see what this does, and I'll hit generate, and we'll see if this creates for us some zigzag patterns. Okay, and here we have some, well, zigzag patterns. And this one looks maybe interesting here, or actually I'm gonna go with this one here. So what I'm gonna do to use this with pattern is I can come over, grab the result, let's drag and drop and place it onto pattern. And so now we're starting to get the pattern, as you can see here. But right now it's on material mode, but what I can do is I can switch this to color only. And so now I have this different color option, which is interesting. And I can increase or decrease the color amount. So right now it's at 4. It kind of depends on the color ranges that have been computed in the result that you have. But for example, if I take this down, you can see that now we're just getting, you know, this value, which is kind of cool. Or I could increase it, you know, to 4 or 5. And now we have the red. But with the color values within the pattern, I can even play around with the hue and get like different results here. So that looks pretty cool as a nice little pattern. And here again, if we take a look here at my 2D view, you can see that this pattern that was generated for me, it is, again, another seamless pattern, saving me time. I don't have to try to tile anything here in my layer stack. So let's take a look at one last example for using pattern. Here I have this metal grinded material that I downloaded from Substance 3D Assets, and I'm gonna jump over to my filters, and I'm gonna take a quick search here for the perforate filter, and so we'll apply this. And so now you can see that we're starting to get some holes here in the surface, and it's set to shape, but we can also input a pattern here, and that's a perfect opportunity for us to use this pattern type. So I'm gonna try random small black dots. And let's see what this does. We'll click generate and let's see if Sampler gives us something interesting. Okay, so here I have some results and I think this one looks pretty cool. So I wanna use this one. And in order to use this with the filter, I'm gonna switch the input type to pattern. And I can just grab one of these generated patterns and just drag and drop and place it here in the shape mask. And there we go. I now have this kind of perforated look. There's a couple options here. I can play around with a few things. Let's see, the chamfer size is always good. So let's just increase this a little bit And there we go, we get a nice little kind of a chamfer effect. So now I have this perforated metal material, and I can keep generating different patterns to get different types of results and variations. Like I said, really good for testing and concepting out the kind of idea or the material that I want to create. Here's a render from a project where you can see several of the materials that were created in Substance Sampler, as well as the patterns I used to create the floral fabric. And here's another render using the bark material that we created in Sampler in this tutorial. The tools we covered in this video are designed to help you iterate, concept, and create variations for materials. The ability to create seamless textures can save time and get you into the creative process more quickly. Thanks a lot for watching, and I'll see you next time.